as we promised. John Ziegler joins us from FramingPaterno.com. And John is fresh off of a visit in the jail cell interview with Jerry Sandusky and his wife Dottie. But also, if you go to FramingPaterno.com, you can read John's article regarding the debut of the movie Happy Valley at the Sundance Film Festival. And John, as a movie reviewer, you're way too honest. Welcome, buddy. Good to talk to you again.
Well, Kevin, we both have that honesty problem, and it's always great to talk to you no matter what radio station you're on. So it's great to catch up.
Well, we appreciate it. Tell us a little bit. Let's go to the movie first. The Happy
sure.
Valley movie debuted at the Sundance Film Festival. You could have been a part of this. You had interviewed a couple of times with the guy that was putting this movie together. Tell our listeners about your experience in that regard. And by the way, for those who are uninitiated with John's work, at FramingPaterno.com, you can see that he has been at the forefront of this Penn State story from the get-go, separating fact from fiction as we go along. All right, John, tell us about your experience with this movie.
Well, I urge people, if they're interested in the details, to go to FramingPaterno.com and read the rather extensive article I wrote about it. But I'll give you the short version. The short version, and by the way, I had a major Hollywood producer call me last night and basically threaten me to take the article down from the website. This was a guy who I thought was a friend and clearly was not. A guy who a large part of your audience would know his name if I told it to you. So clearly I got under somebody's skin here. And basically, the person who runs the company who produced this film, ironically enough, was part of the Second Mile, the charity that Jerry Sandusky founded. And he was a counselor for sure. I thought he was a participant, but he may not have been. But he was also a big Joe Paterno and Penn State fan growing up. And when I spoke with him, it was very clear that he had totally bought into this narrative, which you and I both know to be false, that everybody in Happy Valley, or, you know, I'm speaking somewhat facetiously, but you know, Happy Valley was an open secret that Jerry Sandusky was a pedophile and that football caused everybody to look the other way and or cover it up. And I tried to explain to him in about a two-hour meeting that this is just not the case. There's just no facts to back this up. It makes no sense. This was actually before the Free Report. And then after the Free Report came out, I met with him again to try to convince him, hey, look, you're looking at this all wrong. And he was going to do a movie on this regardless. And, you know, we talked about me potentially directing it, but it was very obvious that I was far too anti-media narrative and far too pro-Paterno for his taste, and it was just not going to work. But I still wanted them to do a good film. I mean, you know me. I care about the truth. It doesn't matter that I'm not working on the film. You know, I want this. It's going to be a major Hollywood documentary opening at Sundance. I wanted to tell the truth of the story. And so I tried very hard and still kept in contact with them to make sure they were up to date in all of the evolution, if you will, of the real facts of this case, the true narrative. And when I interviewed Jerry Sandusky last year and went on the Today Show to discuss it, they contacted me and they said, well, rather arrogantly, can we have the interview? And I said, well, I'll give you the transcript, but if you want the interview, we can talk, make some sort of a deal. And I gave them the transcript, and apparently they didn't like the facts that were in there because they never got back to me after that. And then when the movie came out and it was clearly starring, I mean literally starring, and he was there at the premiere with the red carpet and speaking afterwards and the whole bit, Matt Sandusky, Jerry Sandusky's former adopted child, who in the middle of the trial claimed that he had been abused by Jerry, even though he had testified in the grand jury that he had never been abused by Jerry and that he had reason to suspect that none of the accusers had been abused by Jerry, and then suddenly flipped right in the middle of the trial, which is not even mentioned in the movie. The notion that Matt Sandusky is the star of this film was, Kevin, it was literally horrifying and disgusting to me, because having spent, you know, 2 years for free investigating this thing, I think that there's a hell of a chance that Matt Sandusky is the worst human being in the entire story. And for him to now steal money from the state of Pennsylvania, become a celebrity, made a star in a movie, just, you know, have a Cheshire Cat grin on a red carpet at Sundance, and be treated as if he is legitimate, is abhorrent to every fiber of my being. And that's why when that Hollywood producer called me last night and said, you got to take this down, this is outrageous, blah, 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 I said, well, go ahead, pound sand, because I know I'm right.
John, why would someone want you to take down your opinion on your website and basically threaten you, as you described, if they don't feel that they're wrong?
Exactly. That's exactly. I almost wrote, although I hesitate. I decided not to, at least not yet, wrote to the producer of this film and said, thanks for verifying everything that I think that about this deal, because there's no other reason why. You're not even man enough to do it to me directly. You could send me an email. You could call me. We've met 3 times. You have a mutual friend do it. Are you kidding? I mean, seriously? That is exactly right, Kevin. You have succinctly, as you usually do, have pinpointed what's really going on here. They know they got caught with their hand in the cookie jar. And I think they know that Matt Sandusky is a liar, or at least they're very... I mean, heck, by the way, the best case scenario for Matt Sandusky is this. He is a admitted perjurer who didn't have the guts as an adult to come forward and save all these other victims, because he says he was, the abuse for him stopped at the age of 15, which is in 1993, which is before any of these other allegations occurred.
And let's keep in mind his original testimony under oath to the grand jury was that he was never abused. He switches midstream during the trial, in which he never testifies.
Right.
And yet he gets millions of dollars in a settlement, which is preposterous to say the least. And here this guy has become a star of a film that is nothing but fiction.
You nailed it, and that's exactly right, and I am positive of it. I mean, there's so few things that anybody can be positive of this realm in this particular saga, but I'm about as positive about this as I can be, and I've written extensively about why Matt Sandusky is not to be believed, and again, you can see that at framingpaterno.com, but I'm exceedingly confident in it from every standpoint, not just the evidence, but also just the logical narrative of how this whole thing evolved. By the way, he not only testified in the grand jury on behalf of Jerry, Kevin, he wanted to hold a press conference afterwards. He was so pissed off at the allegations. This was just before Jerry got arrested. They said that, but he was dissuaded from doing that by his attorney, and the attorney that ended up representing him and getting him millions of dollars from Penn State is the same attorney who has represented 8 other so-called victims, all of whom have almost exactly the same type of allegation, which is not nearly as horrific as what most people would believe happened in this case. By the way, Matt's allegation is remarkably benign. He claims that he suddenly remembered in the middle of the trial via repressed memory therapy, which is total bullcrap. I mean, nobody believes in repressed memory therapy. It's not even allowed in a lot of courtrooms, as you know. But he claims that somewhere between the ages of 8 and 15, Jerry would blow kisses on his stomach and grazed his penis with his hand, which is an odd allegation, first of all, for that never to evolve past that in 7 years, but also just happens to be the perfect allegation, if you think about it, so he doesn't have to admit he was engaged in any sort of gay sex, but it's just enough for him to get the millions of dollars from Penn State.
Well, here's what's interesting to me, John. He had this epiphany of this repressed memory that came all of a sudden to the forefront in the middle of the trial, as he surmised, oh, things aren't going well for Jerry, maybe I can cash in. And you talked to an expert in repressed memory, if I'm correct.
Yep.
And she said balderdash.
Right. Dr. Elizabeth Loftus from UC Irvine here in California, world's foremost memory expert, she laughed at this concept of repressed memory therapy under these conditions. And by the way, again, Kevin, your instincts are so good, because when I saw Jerry last week, Jerry says to me, and if you think about this is highly credible, because he has no reason to say this, okay? He says to me, in hindsight, I probably made a mistake telling Matt just before the trial that victim number 2, the boy from the Mike McQueary episode, had flipped from being a supporter to now claiming to be some semblance of a victim. And Jerry says that it was at that moment that he believes Matt did exactly what you just said, which is he saw which way the wind was blowing. He realized he needed to be on the winning team. And he, just a very short while later, decided, yep, I'm out of here. I'm on the other team, and I'm going to cash out. And by the way, think about it this way, Kevin. If Jerry really had abused Matt Sandusky, he would obviously know that he did it, and he would know that Matt. Matt knew that he did it. Why in the world would Jerry tell Matt just before the trial, oh, by the way, some of our biggest supporters are flipping the other side? I mean, that would be asinine, completely insane. And Jerry, you know, Jerry is not insane. I'm quite positive of that.
All right, John Ziegler is with us from FramingPaterno.com. He's fresh off of a jailhouse interview with Jerry Sandusky and his wife, Dottie. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to get into the nuts and bolts of that, now that we've dissected that movie fiasco that made it to Sundance, John, which, by the way, how in the world did that ever make it to the Sundance Film Festival?
Well, I'm told that it never even got vetted there because the director had a film previous at Sundance, and so the vetting process is not nearly as stringent. But, you know, frankly, it probably would have gotten through anyway because nobody knows the facts of this case, and no one seems to care. That's what's so crazy about it, Kevin.
That's so true. Let's take a break, and we'll come right back with John Ziegler. We'll get into the jailhouse interview with Jerry Sandusky and his wife, Dottie, right after this live from... Welcome back, John Ziegler from FramingPaterno.com. We discussed the Happy Valley movie premiere at the Sundance Film Festival and what a joke that was. And now, John, you have had the opportunity to have a second jailhouse interview with Jerry Sandusky, and this time his wife accompanied you there. So you sat down with both of them. Was this an opportunity for Jerry and his wife to move you in a direction they wanted to move you in?
Well, I guess in a way it was, but, you know, just to clarify, obviously the context here is important. When I interviewed Jerry last year before I went on the Today Show and debuted the 3.5-hour audio interview, probably the last of its kind that Jerry will ever be able to do, from a very high-security prison in Pennsylvania, my focus there, as you well know, was on whether or not Joe Paterno had been given a raw deal, whether he'd been railroaded, whether Penn State could have possibly covered this up in any way. And it was very clear to me that my instincts and your instincts on this story were correct, that there was absolutely, positively no way that that made any sense whatsoever, nor was there any evidence to back up that fantasy. So it really wasn't that much about Jerry, except for the, you know, obviously the Mike McQuarrie episode we got into deeply, because that was the one that Penn State clearly knew about and Joe Paterno was somewhat told about. So that was the focus. Well, you know, as you well know, Kevin, you know, I'm not having anything to do with Penn State here. I went to Georgetown. I put out a free documentary film, a free book on this case. I'm not getting paid. I'm just doing this because I think the truth here got lost. And I first thought, well, Jerry's got to be at least mostly guilty because, you know, my God, not everybody could possibly be this wrong. Even as much of a cynic as I am about the news media, I thought there's just no way that everybody got this case that wrong. But as I got deeper and deeper into this, I started to have some questions. And so I wanted to ask Jerry and Dottie to meet with me together. And this time it was to be about him. And the reason I asked them to both be there, Kevin, was because I full well realize no one wants to believe anything that Jerry Sandusky or even Dottie has to say about this. I get that. However, I believe that you can still discern important elements of this story simply from the way people react to certain situations or questions or topics. And I thought it was interesting that Jerry and Dottie both even agreed to meet with me. Because you got to remember, I went on national television and called him a pedophile, okay? I mean, when Matt Lauer asked me 3 straight times, is he guilty, is he guilty, is he guilty, a topic I wanted to avoid because I had suspicions that he wasn't as guilty as everybody says he was, but I also didn't want to, you know, blow up my main purpose here, which was to exonerate Joe Paterno, and I realized the news media would be completely fixated on the Jerry Sandusky element. I tried to dodge the question. I couldn't, and I basically said, look, he's probably guilty of most of these charges, but there were major due process problems with the trial. Well, as I got deeper and deeper into it, Kevin, some of this stuff just doesn't make sense. The narrative just doesn't make sense. It doesn't fit with the known evidence, and it doesn't fit with the way Jerry and Dottie have reacted in the situations where I have seen them. And just by virtue of the fact that they would both agree to meet with me, they know I'm a hard ass for the truth. They know I don't give a damn. They know there's a very good chance I'm going to go in there and blow them apart. Why would Jerry agree to let Dottie, his last strong, real supporter, who comes to see him driving 4 hours alone every day, both ways, to see him once a week, why would he put himself in a situation where I might reveal to her that he's a big fraud and a total pedophile, right? And vice versa. Why would Dottie put herself in a situation if she was remotely afraid of having, you know, the light finally shown into her eyes that Jerry is this hideous, horrible pedophile? Why would she agree to do it? So right off the bat, I thought, okay, this is interesting that they're both willing to do this and they're both willing to be totally open. And then some of the things that I found in the way they reacted to situations, Kevin, just made me convinced that there is no consciousness of guilt on their part. It's just not there. And I have tried everything. I have tried it via, you know, the 6 hours plus that I've spent with him in prison over the last 2 years, hours on the phone with Dottie, dozens of letters that I've exchanged with Jerry. I've done everything possible, and not one time have I seen consciousness of guilt. And by the way, this is not Jerry Sandusky on a couch sipping a martini. He is huddled in front of me, you know, with his handcuffs so tight he can't even touch his face, in an orange jumpsuit where he hasn't been sleeping, hasn't been eating properly, and obviously been almost in solitary confinement for most of the time. So this is not exactly the situation where somebody could pull the wool over me, all right? I'm a super cynic. And this was not a softball Larry King situation. We were contentious with one another. I believe that at one point or another, I yelled at Jerry. Jerry yelled at me. Jerry yelled at Dottie. Dottie yelled at Jerry. Dottie yelled at me. I mean, it was that contentious. But I'm telling you, and there was a prime moment, if you want me to tell you about it, I'd be happy to, that really made it come home to me that for better or for worse, right or wrong, he does not have the proper consciousness of guilt required to support the narrative about him. It's just not there.
So I have to ask you then, John, are you saying that you've reversed your thinking on Jerry Sandusky, that he's innocent?
No, no one can say that because there's too much doubt about, you know, what the interaction between him and these boys was really all about. Obviously, he did things that he admits were stupid and inappropriate, the showering with young boys and what have you. But here's what I am saying. You know, Kevin, the analogy that I came up with, which may or may not work, you can tell me if it does, this whole Penn State situation to me is like an algebraic equation. And there's two unknowns. There's the why, which is the why factor, which would be Joe Paterno and Penn State's alleged knowledge or involvement in the supposed cover-up. And then there's X. And the X factor is Jerry Sandusky's actual crimes. Now, nobody has been able, except maybe me, I believe, has been able to make the equation work in the known evidence. And there's two reasons for that. You would obviously agree with me. It's because the Y factor has been completely miscalculated, right? Are you following me here?
Yes, sir.
The Joe Paterno Penn State angle has been completely misinterpreted and blown totally and completely out of proportion of reality by the news media. So no one's putting in the proper why. But even among the Paterno supporters, I don't believe anyone's putting in the proper X value either. And that's why the equation never comes out to making any sense. And the only equation that makes sense in the totality of the evidence and the only narrative that I can come up with that fits with the way human beings are even remotely likely to react and is consistent with everything that I've seen with Jerry and Dottie and the evidence, and by the way, other people surrounding him, is that the X factor is, if not zero, it's damn close to zero. And I can never obviously say it's zero. And by the way, I'm not saying people want to go, oh my God, this is outrageous. He's saying that the victims are all liars. Actually, no. Because if you know the evidence, and nobody is stupid enough to delve into the evidence like I have for the last 2 years, right? Let's face it, few people are.
I'll have to raise my hand and claim guilt there too.
Right, okay, but you know the evidence of this case. But if you look at it, we're not really talking about that many kids that would have to be, what I'm saying, is manipulated by others who had a huge incentive for them to say things that were not true, and then for them themselves to have a huge incentive. And, I guess...
Were there, John, times when Jerry Sandusky's wife, sitting there in jail with you doing this interview, were there times when she was pushing you to ask him questions that may make him look bad?
Yeah, that was one of the more interesting and shocking things. There was something that I had asked her about regarding, you know, I'm trying to track down the McQueary victim. I know who he is. I know virtually everything about him. I think I know where he lives. I've got email addresses. I've got his wife's phone number, his mom's phone number. And I'm trying to, you know, so I've done quite a bit of investigation on this because I want him to come forward and tell the real truth of what happened here.
You've probably done more than the prosecution did.
Oh, for sure. Well, they didn't want to talk to him. He never testified because they didn't like his story.
Exactly.
And so Dottie had remembered that I had a question about something I found on a Facebook page involving Victim 2's brother that was a little disconcerting. And I had forgotten to ask Jerry about it. Well, Dottie, at least 4 or 5 times during my conversation in prison, said, don't forget to ask Jerry about this. Don't forget to ask Jerry about it. Now, if she is remotely concerned, right, that she would have to know, not just because she was his wife, but because the testimony in the case actually involves her being a witness in two very key episodes. So she would have to know he's a pedophile, right? And if she really was concerned about it, why would she be pushing me to ask him? That's number one. But to me, the most profound moment occurred, Kevin, when I asked both of them. I said, what was the moment that you knew that you were in big trouble, that this was not going to turn out okay, that you were going down for this? Now, as you and I know, as an outside observer, there were 100 moments during this where anybody knew, oh, my gosh, you know, this is big trouble. I mean, obviously, the Costas interview was a huge one. You know, the arrest, the McQueary allegations, you know, all sorts of different time periods when that could have been the moment. And Jerry, and he thinks about it, and he very sincerely, with a tear rolling down his cheek that he can't even brush away because he's got the handcuffs so tight on his hands, says to me, it must have been the reading of the verdicts. And Dottie immediately agrees, and she starts bawling, fighting back the tears with everything she could. She eventually has to leave the room, and Jerry goes into great detail about how he almost blacked out when the verdicts were being read because he was so shocked that this was what was happening, that he had so much faith in the system that this couldn't be happening to him. And so I was profoundly impacted by this because there's no chance in the world they'd ever been asked this question before. There's no chance in the world they had contrived their answer. There's no chance in the world they're such good actors they could simultaneously both be bawling their eyes out. And so then I went to their attorney, Joe Amendola, a couple days later. And Joe didn't know anything about this or this question. I said, Joe, you were there. Tell me what you think their answer was going to be. And Joe thinks about it for 3 or 4 seconds, and he says, was it the reading of the verdicts? And I go, that's exactly what it was.
All right, now let me play devil's advocate for you, John.
You understand why that's significant, right, Kevin?
Of course I do.
There's no consciousness of guilt there.
Definitely. Now, playing devil's advocate, could the Sanduskies have talked prior to you coming out there and played you, because I've been played before unwittingly. It's amazing that it happens, but it does. Could that have been the situation here where you were set up to preach their story that this is indeed the case? That's what the devil's advocate side is going to say.
Sure, and I understand why, you know, no one wants, I'm fully aware no one wants to believe anything I'm saying. I get it. I'm aware of that, and they're going to come up with whatever rationality they can to not believe me, because I don't even believe, I can't believe that I've come to this point in the story where this is what I've now, you know, essentially believe with some caveats. But I got to tell you, here's Kevin with my response to that. The interaction that I've had with both of them has been extensive, and it has been in situations that could not possibly have been rehearsed or anticipated. And neither of these are polished people. Jerry is 70 years old, basically living in solitary confinement in a maximum security prison, all right? Dottie is almost the same age. There's just, it's just not possible. I mean, I kind of go back to this analogy of, remember how George Bush was both the incredible dunce and also the guy who was manipulating the whole world to get us into a war in Iraq and find, you know, Halliburton and weapon. Right. I mean, so to me, it's the same kind of deal with Jerry and Dottie. They're either the greatest criminal minds in the history of the world, the greatest actors, the greatest puppeteers, the greatest manipulators that have ever lived, or they're naive and they got caught into a really bad situation that their religion, and both of them are very religious people, and I think religion has played a huge, huge, huge role here, because they think God is going to take care of this. They think God, you know, who apparently is on a vacation when it comes to them for quite an extended period of time, that God is going to make sure that all this turns out in this life or the next. And the reality is, it's just not possible based upon what I've seen. And here's how you would know, Kevin, with the greatest manipulator and the guy who's been able to get away with this for 40 years, not be able to answer Bob Costas's question on the phone, are you sexually attracted to young boys?
It's preposterous, but right. A lot of this is preposterous, and this stuff gets me going. You're the only guy who's sat in there and spoken to these people, and yet I still have trouble coming to the conclusion that he's anything but the monster he was depicted as, and maybe, just maybe, he's the Cheshire Cat.
I understand why you thought that, and I thought it too when I interviewed him the first time, but there's several presumptions and assumptions that even I made that were incorrect. Almost, here's another analogy for you, Kevin. Here's how I now see this case.
Give me that one, and then we got to run to a break.
Okay, this case is like a giant mural where everybody is looking at the mural from 6 inches away. I'm now looking at it from 15 feet away, and I realize the entire mural is intended to be looked at upside down. That's how crazy this case is, all right? And I realize no one's going to believe me, but when I now see it in the full frame, it makes total sense to me. It really does.
And I always keep an open door because I've heard people lie about people all the time. So my door is always open to hear the explanation. And it's interesting that you're the only one who's sat down with him. John, fantastic stuff. You can read about it on framingpaterno.com. As always, great stuff, and we'll talk again soon.
Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you, John. That's John Ziegler. Hey, folks.